إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدًا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم، يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. وقال تعالى أيضا: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. We ask Allah the Almighty to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, first and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and then all of you all who are present here to adopt a life of taqwa, and that is to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during every single second of our lives if we wish to attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. Just 4 weeks back, we were in the blessed month of Ramadan. It was the first week of the last month and I did the khutbah in the same masjid. Now 4 weeks later, Ramadan is over, our Eid is over, and now I'm here for the first khutbah after Ramadan. Allahu Akbar. This just made me realize in the morning that Ramadan whizzed past by. In other words, Ramadan whizzed past us in such a rapid pace. Allahu Akbar. It was as if I did the khutbah last week. It was so fast. I would say this is the fastest Ramadan ever, because Ramadan went so fast. Time has indeed been crumpled up. Allahu Akbar. We are rapidly heading towards Judgment Day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease the questioning upon us. We are rapidly headed towards the day of Qiyamah. Many scholars, rahimahumullah, have researched in regard to the signs of the day of Qiyamah, in regard to Ashratu Sa'ah, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us in regard to the signs of the day of Qiyamah, and all of that has been informed to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because after all, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he does not speak out of his own desires. Whatever he utters is divine inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So scholars, rahimahumullah, they explain in regard to Ashratu Sa'ah, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that the signs of the day of Qiyamah are of two types. We have major signs of the day of Qiyamah and minor signs of the day of Qiyamah. Know for a fact, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that in regard to the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, Ashratu Sa'ati Sughra, the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, most of them have already occurred. Allahu Akbar. Most of them have already taken place. Only another few of those minor signs are remaining, and then the major signs of the day of Qiyamah will inevitably start. Allahu Akbar. And in regard to the major signs of the day of Qiyamah, don't think, oh, we haven't still witnessed even one of the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. We have got plenty of time. Let the major signs begin, and then let me turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our beloved master, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is reported to have said along the lines of these words, that in regard to the major signs of the day of Qiyamah, even if one of those signs were to take place, the remaining major signs would start occurring one after the other consecutively, just as how if a pearl necklace were to break, just as how the beads would fall one after the other at a very rapid pace, the major signs of the day of Qiyamah will occur one after the other. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. When we look around, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we look around, we see so much of trials, so much of calamities, and especially the Muslim Ummah is going through a lot of hardship. Allahu Akbar. You see protests everywhere for what is going on in Gaza. You see the children each and every day, you go on your news feed, you go check your WhatsApp, you check your emails perhaps, you're getting horrifying images about what is happening in Gaza. Children are being butchered, children are being murdered, mass murders are taking place. All of these are from the signs of the day of Qiyamah. In other words, this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is headed at a very rapid pace towards Judgment Day. Towards Judgment Day. So I thought of basing today's khutbah, inshaAllah ta'ala, a bit about the signs of the day of Qiyamah, and we will try to elaborate a bit more on Mahdi. On the Mahdi who is supposed to come, inshaAllah ta'ala. Now in regard to the major signs of the day of Qiyamah, the hadith is in Muslim. Hudhayfah ibn Asir ibn al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu, he states that once ittala'a alayna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The narration goes along the lines of these words, that once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to us whilst we were seated in gatherings, we were discussing about something. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to us and he asks us, oh my Sahaba, what are you all discussing about? Ma tadhakarun, what are you all discussing about? To which the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they replied that, ya Rasulullah, we are discussing about as-sa'ah. We are discussing about the final ah. We are discussing about the day of Qiyamah. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches them that, oh my Sahaba, the narration goes along the lines of these words, oh my Sahaba, the last hour, the final hour, the day of judgment will not occur until 10 major signs occur. Until 10 major signs occur, the day of Qiyamah will not take place. Allahu Akbar. And then he went on to mention the signs, the major signs. Now, I'm giving you the major signs from many narrations. These have been recorded from many narrations. The order is not specified. The order is not specified because the narrations, in the different narrations, the orders vary. So nevertheless, these are from the signs of the day of Qiyamah. And even if one were to take place, like I said in the beginning, the remaining would occur one after the other consecutively. So from the major signs of the day of Qiyamah, number one is the appearance of Mahdi. Mahdi will come. The appearance of Mahdi is one of the signs of one of the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. Next in line is Dajjal, otherwise known as Antichrist. Dajjal, he will come about. Known as Masihud Dajjal, he will come. This is also from the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. And then we have the descending of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Now before we go on to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, in regard to Dajjal, in regard to Antichrist, this individual, Some people have taken this term Dajjal and translated it, or they have interpreted it to be as a metaphor. And they have at times interpreted Dajjal to be the World Wide Web, or Dajjal to be the television, or Dajjal to be the media, or Dajjal to be all kinds of things. But we cannot rely on those interpretations, because the description of Dajjal is very explicit in the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no need for us to delve into interpretations. There is no need for ta'wilat here, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has very clearly described Dajjal for us. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in many narrations, he has described Dajjal as being from the children of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Dajjal is a human being who will come about from the children of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. He will be a well-built individual, a stocky, well-built individual. He will have a ruddy complexion, a reddish complexion. He will have curly hair. He will be one-eyed. In other words, he will look through one eye, and his other eye, the right eye, will be like a floating grape in his socket, in the eye socket. And likewise, he will be sterile. He will have no children. So all of these descriptions, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, can never ever fit the interpretation of the World Wide Web. Does the World Wide Web have curly hair? Does the World Wide Web have... Is it well built? Is it sterile? None of these descriptions fit any of those interpretations. So from this we understand that no doubt he will be from the children of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam is also reported to have said that the fitna of Dajjal will be the greatest fitna that the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam will have to face. Allahu Akbar. And that is why our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam used to pray in every salah, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min a'dhab al-qabr wa min a'dhab al-nar wa min fitnati al-mahya wal-mamat wa min fitnati al-masih al-dajjal. Because the trials, the calamities of Dajjal will be so great. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the fitna of Dajjal. In another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that Dajjal will rampage. He will rampage on the face of this earth for 40 days. For 40 days he will rampage and cause so much of mischief, so much of corruption. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. The first day from those 40 days will be like a year, will be like 365 days. The second day from those 40 days will be like a month. And the third day from those 40 days will be like a week. And then the remaining 37 days will be like our usual days. Allahu Akbar. He will rampage, he will cause so much of corruption. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. And it will be at that time, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will descend. Allahu Akbar. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will descend. Will descend from where? He will descend from the heavens, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the one who took him up to the heavens. Unlike what the Christians say, that they crucified Jesus, that is not correct. وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the noble Quran, they did not kill him, they did not murder him. وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ, nor did they crucify him. وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ, but it was shown as if it was something similar to that. It was a drama shown to them. Allahu Akbar. But رَفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised him up to the heavens. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will descend from the heavens. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name. He, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He has taught us so much. He even went on to describe how Isa alayhi salatu wasallam will descend, in what manner will he descend, what, even to the extent to what clothing Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will wear when he will descend. Allahu Akbar. The hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said in an authentic hadith that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will descend. He will descend upon the white minarets, the white minarets of the masjid towards the east of Damascus in Syria. Towards the east of Dimashq, in other words, Damascus in Syria. He will descend bearing or wearing two pieces, two articles of clothing which will be close to a creamy yellow color. He will be wearing two pieces of clothing which will be close to a light yellow color. And he will descend with his hands resting on the wings of two angels. Allahu Akbar. Look at the description of our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will descend with his hands resting on the wings of two angels. He will be wearing a cream, a light yellow piece of clothing, two pieces of clothing. And he will descend with his two hands resting on the wings of two angels. He will descend on the white minarets of the masjid towards the east of Damascus in Syria. And he will lower his head and he will raise his head. He will lower his head and he will raise his head. Each time he lowers his head and raises his head, drops of water will fall from his face like pearls, glittering and sparkling like pearls. And scholars rahimahumullah explain, it will be because of the purity of that water. Water will be dripping from his face, and he, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, will descend. And when he descends, for his mere breath, Allahu Akbar, the minute an infidel, the minute a kafir, the minute a disbeliever, the minute an idolater even gets a whiff of the breath of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he will fall down dead. Allahu Akbar. And his breath, the breath of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, will travel as far as his eyes will be able to see. As far as his eyesight will reach, his breath will travel and it will kill all of the kuffar in its path. Allahu Akbar. The minute he descends, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, he, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, will head towards Baytul Maqdis. For what reason? To kill Dajjal. He, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, will kill Dajjal. We'll come back to that. We move on to the next sign. The next sign is Ya'juj and Ma'juj, otherwise known as Gog and Magog. Ya'juj and Ma'juj, these are individuals. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them as a test. They are individuals where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has described them to be individuals with faces hammered in like sheep. Their faces will be like hammered in shields. Like when you take a shield that you use for protection in war, and when you hammer it in, just as how the features go in, they will have chinky eyes, small noses and small mouths. They will be individuals, no offense to the Chinese, but having a kind of a Chinese description. The Ya'juj and Ma'juj, they will also cause a lot of fitna, a lot of trials. They are also from the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. In another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has reported to have said that in regard to Ya'juj and Ma'juj, suddenly he informed the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. The narration goes along the lines of these words, that the barrier that is preventing Ya'juj and Ma'juj from coming out, this was at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said that a hole this big, and he showed it like this, rounding his forefinger with his thumb, a hole this big has opened up in the barrier of the, in other words, the barrier that is preventing Ya'juj and Ma'juj from coming out. And then the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, will that trial and calamity be put upon the people even if there are righteous people amongst the ummah? Towards which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam clarifies, the narration goes along the lines of these words, that if evil becomes widespread, if evil becomes widespread, Allahu Akbar, we are living in such a time. People are turning a blind eye towards what's happening. Innocent children are being killed. Innocent women are being raped. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviate the sufferings of the Muslim ummah. And may He help our brethren in Gaza and in all other places. We are living in such cruel and evil times. If evil becomes widespread, then the trials and calamities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will descend upon the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next sign, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is that there will be khusuf. There will be three major swallowing up of the earth. There will be three major earthquakes. one towards the east, one towards the west, and one in the lands of Arabia. This is also from the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. And then there will be a dukhan, a smoke that will break out. And then the next sign will be the rising of the sun from the west, upon which the doors of Tawbah will be slammed shut. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to turn to Him before the doors of Tawbah will be slammed shut. The next sign will be the appearance of Ad-Dabbah, of the beast, of a big animal. A beast will come out. This animal will go around and strike the faces of the people. The believers, their faces will be illuminated. But on the other hand, the faces of the kuffar will bear a mark on their noses. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. The next and final sign will be that a great fire will break out from the direction of Yemen, from the bottom of Aden, from the sea of Hadramaut. A great fire will break out, which will gather all of the remaining mankind to commence the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. These are the major signs of the day of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. And may He the Almighty forgive all of our sins. Coming back to Isa alayhi salatu wa salam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states, and the hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, kayfa antum? In other words, the translation goes as, you could state it as, how lucky are y'all, or how fortunate are y'all, that Isa alayhi salatu wa sallam will descend. Isa alayhi salatu wa sallam, Isa ibn Maryam will descend, and when he descends, your imam, your leader will be from amongst you. Wa imamukum minkum. Allahu Akbar. When Isa alayhi salatu wasalam descends, like I said, he will go to Baytul Maqdis. And before that, when he comes, the iqama will be said for a prayer. The iqama will be said for a prayer. In another narration, this has been described, and the narration goes along the lines of these words. When he comes and when he descends, the iqama will be said for a prayer. And at that time, that gathering that will be gathered at that point, a person from that gathering, the leader of that gathering, will look towards Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and he will identify Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and he will ask Isa alayhi salatu wasalam to be the imam of the salah, to conduct the salah. To which Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will say, no, you are the amir, and he will make that individual conduct the salah, and he will also say that it is takrumatullahi lihadihi al-ummah. It is a miracle, or it is an honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that individual will be al-Mahdi. That individual will be al-Mahdi. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, there are many narrations in regard to al-Mahdi. But sadly, we have some individuals who reject al-Mahdi. Who reject al-Mahdi. There are some individuals who reject al-Mahdi. And there is a difference of opinion amongst the scholars, to which some scholars state that there aren't many ahadith that talk about Mahdi. They say that there are only very few mutawatir ahadith that talk about Mahdi, and the remaining ahadith that talk about Mahdi are hadith ahad. Don't worry, I will explain. What is a mutawatir hadith? A mutawatir narration is a successive narration. It is a successive hadith. In other words, in the chain of the narrators, there is such a huge number of narrators. When you analyze the chain of the hadith, there is such a huge number of narrators that it is impossible to think that such a huge number of narrators would have decided to lie against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the authenticity has been established in regard to mutawatir ahadith. On the other hand, khabar ahad or hadith ahad is the exact opposite of mutawatir, where there will be only one narrator in each link narrating the hadith. There will be only one narrator narrating the hadith. So it is the exact opposite of mutawatir. So it is also established amongst those scholars that you can't use hadith ahad, you can't use khabar ahad in regard to things that are in relationship to i'tiqad, in relationship to aqidah, in relationship to creed and belief. But they say that you can use those ahadith for ahkam, for fiqh and etc. But then the other school of thought, the other scholars, rahimahumullah, they state no. Even a khabar ahad, even if it is just one narrator narrating, if that hadith has been established in regard to its authenticity, then it is upon us to accept the hadith because it is from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also have individuals who only accept ahadith from the two books, Bukhari and Muslim, which is very wrong. We have some individuals who only accept a hadith from Bukhari and Muslim, which is very wrong. Because the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and when we say sunnah, what we mean is the ahadith, the aqwal, the af'al, all of the things related to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is not only restricted to the two books, Bukhari and Muslim. We have many other books that have recorded the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, such as the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, the Sunan of Imam Ibn Majah, the Sunan of At-Tirmidhi, the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawood, the Sunan of other books, and so many other books of ahadith. We have the Musnad of Bazzar. We have so many books of ahadith that have recorded thousands or tens of thousands of ahadith that cannot be just shunned away just because we only believe the ahadith that are recorded in Bukhari and Muslim. Nay, that is a wrong mentality. But rather, we have to refer, we have to analyze a hadith based on what the ulama, what the salafun as-salih, what the ulama, the scholars of jarh and ta'dil, the scholars of hadith, the experts in a hadith, what they state in regard to a hadith. If they have declared a hadith to be authentic, if the authenticity of the hadith has been established, then it is upon us to accept that hadith. Because if you want a good example in regard to khabar ahad, in regard to a hadith ahad, we know of the situation where the qibla was changed. We know of the situation where the qibla was changed. The sahaba, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, were in salah. One individual comes and he says that the qibla has been changed. Now they did not say, no, we need a whole group of people to come and tell us, we can't believe your word because you're just one individual coming and informing us. No, the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in immediately turned around towards the new qibla. Towards the new qibla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the noble Quran,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَإٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا.
O you who believe, if a fasiq, if a sinner, if an evildoer comes with a piece of information, then verify that piece of information. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say if a believer comes with a piece of information, verify it. Or Allah the Almighty did not generally say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, in ja'akum khabaru fatabayyanu. If a piece of information comes to you, verify it. No, but rather on the other hand, it is from the qualities of a believer that he will not lie. If a believer, if a righteous person comes about with a piece of information, there is no need to verify it to a great deal. But on the other hand, if he is known for his evil doing, if he is known for his transgressions, then it is upon us to verify in regard to the piece of information that he brings. And that is why the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in did not hesitate when another Sahabi brought the news that the Qibla has been changed. They immediately changed their Qibla. It is a khabar ahad. It is a narration that only one person brought it. Likewise, in terms of ahadith, we refer back to the scholars who are the experts in hadith, and if the authenticity is established, it is upon us to accept it that it is from the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we have no right whatsoever to reject the words of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. A few more minutes in regard to Mahdi. The hadith is in Abu Dawud. It is an authentic narration, and this hadith has been mentioned in other places too. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he states that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that the hour will not take place, the final hour will not take place, the narration goes along the lines of these words, until a man appears, who will be from my descendants. He will be from the descendants of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will be, in another narration that has been mentioned, he will be from the Ahl Bayt of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will bear the same name as our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In other words, his name will also be Muhammad. Allahu Akbar. And his father's name will be the same name as our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's father's name. In other words, his father's name will also be Abdullah. He will be known as Muhammad ibn Abdullah. So his name will be Muhammad, his father's name will also be the same. And then in another narration also, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said, يُسْلِحُهُ اللَّهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ. Allahu Akbar. He will be geared. In other words, he will be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will gear him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prepare him to lead the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in just one night. Allahu Akbar. In just one night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prepare him, will prepare him, will gear him to lead the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Just imagine, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we live in a time when a piece of information comes out, it is immediately blown out of proportion. People are in utter confusion. They don't know what to do. We had the recent issue of someone claiming for Khilafah. We know how people were confused. People did not know where to turn, what to do. Allahu Akbar. But look at the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Mahdi appears, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prepare him in one night. In one night for what? To lead the whole ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The whole ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will unite under him. Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I leave you all with an amazing narration. A narration that fills all of us with so much of hope. Do not lose hope. When you look around you and when you see all of these trials, all of these calamities, do not lose hope. Don't think that it is the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't think it is the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It could be the exact opposite. It could be the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have some individuals stating very hurtful statements, saying that it could be the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the people of Gaza. Al-iyadu billah. Who are we to be so judgmental? How can we judge the people of Gaza? It could be the exact opposite. It could be the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the people of Gaza. They are all dying as martyrs. They have been guaranteed Jannah. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them the highest stations in Jannah. So when we look around, it is upon us to strengthen our iman. Let us not let our iman dwindle, because we live in times where holding on to your iman is like holding on to a piece of coal. When you look around at all these things happening, we should not lose our iman. Rather, we should be steadfast. We should be strong. We should fill our hearts with unwavering patience. We should hope for the best from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this amazing hadith. The hadith is in Musnad of Imam Ahmad. And it has also been mentioned in other books of a hadith. It is an authentic narration. Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu states that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, and the narration goes along the lines of these words, there will be an era of prophethood. There will be an era of prophethood, and that will last for how long Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes it to last. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove that era of prophethood. And it will be followed by a khilafah. By a khilafah which will be based upon the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have seen these things manifesting. Right after the nubuwwah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we had the khilafah. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say that khilafah will last for how long Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes it to last. And then Allah the Almighty will remove that khilafah. And then that khilafah will be followed by an autocratic monarchy, by a dictatorship of a type of a monarchy, a rule. And that will also last for however long Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes it to last. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove it. And then that will be followed by a tyrannical monarchy. Allahu Akbar. It will be followed by a tyrannical monarchy. The kings, the leaders will be tyrants. They will be oppressors. They will be dictators. It will be followed by a tyrannical rule, a tyrannical monarchy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let that remain for however long He wishes it to remain. And then, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty will remove that And then that will be followed by a khilafah once again. Allahu Akbar. It will be followed by a khilafah based upon the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the khilafah is coming indeed. The khilafah is inevitable in accordance with the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The khilafah is coming, the victory for the Muslims is coming. Be patient, put your hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not lose hope, do not lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put all your affairs in the trust of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty will never let down the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as long as we are upright. So let us be upright. Let us hope for the best from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, we will be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. And may He the Almighty alleviate the sufferings of the Muslim Ummah. May He alleviate the sufferings of our brethren in Gaza. May He accept the shuhada from them. May He have mercy upon them. May He help them against the struggle, against these infidels, against the kuffar. May He destroy those who are oppressing them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May He the Almighty accept our good deeds. And may He keep us steadfast on the straight path. May He fill our hearts with strong iman. May He fill our hearts with strong, unwavering patience. And may He unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah, just as how He united us here this afternoon with our beloved.